Greetings, everyone. Greetings. I would like to extend an especially warm welcome to our new faculty and also welcome back all returning faculty. I'll introduce myself. I'm Gina Greco, Professor of French in the Department of World Languages and Literatures, and I stand here today as presiding officer of the Faculty Senate. This convocation, like all convocations set at the beginning of an academic year, marks a transition between past and future in the cyclical calendar of the university. Part of the program today will look towards the past, to recognize the achievements of faculty who have excelled in the areas of scholarship, teaching, and service. Other parts of the program will look towards the future, with special emphasis on the directions to be set by the strategic plan. As presiding officer of the Senate, I would like to take advantage of my 5, not 15, I've been cautioned, minutes of fame, to look at the future that I envisioned for the Faculty Senate and to call on all faculty to participate in shared governance. In the current climate of educational angst, a day hardly goes by without an article in a major national publication, the New York Times, Washington Post, let alone the Chronicle of Higher Education, either calling into question the value of a university education or defending a university education under assault. Rather than a threat, I see this as a challenge, and even more so as an opportunity for us as a campus to launch a conversation about what it should mean to be a PSU graduate and how we can best articulate that to ourselves, our students, and our community. I would like us to assess where we are succeeding and where we can improve in our work to prepare students for success in the workplace, yes, but also for meaningful participation in their communities, for personal growth, and for the pursuit of lifetime learning. I recognize that we already have campus-wide learning outcomes, and that could perhaps be a place to start. Are our learning outcomes transparent to students? I don't mean can they find them on the web or on our syllabi, but do we articulate how our pedagogical choices contribute to student learning? Increased pedagogical transparency has been shown to improve student engagement and success, especially for first-generation college students. I will call this conversation an exploration of liberal education. Please note that liberal education is related to, but not limited to, the notion of the liberal arts. A liberal education, as defined by the Association of American Colleges and Universities, is an approach to learning that empowers individuals and prepares them to deal with complexity, diversity, and change. It provides students with a broad knowledge of the wider world, for example, science, culture, and society, as well as in-depth study in a specific area of interest. A liberal education helps students develop a sense of social responsibility, as well as strong and transferable intellectual and practical skills, such as communication, analytical and problem-solving skills, and a demonstrated ability to apply knowledge and skills in real-world settings. I agree, they repeat the word skills too frequently, but I like their philosophy and it resonates with our mission at PSU. More on the specifics to come, particularly in relation to our students and curriculum at PSU and our campus's vision of what we value and represent. In my closing minute today, I would like to announce that the Senate will be calling on faculty participation in a variety of pointed and meaningful conversations through task forces, campus colloquia, et cetera, about liberal education, about the possibility of tenure for teaching, and about other ideas that will come from the strategic plan and initiatives conceived through the fruitful, albeit excruciatingly slow, contract negotiations currently in progress between the AUP and the administration. Please stay tuned for calls to self-nominate for task forces in our efforts to include as many new and varied voices as possible in the discussions and deliberations. That's it for my plug. Welcome again to all here today. I now introduce Jonathan Fink, Vice President for Research and Strategic Partnerships, who will present the Faculty Research Awards, and kudos to all faculty whose work will be acknowledged today.
Thank you, Gina, and welcome to everybody. It's a pleasure to be here today to talk a little bit about the Faculty Research Excellence Awards. These awards were started just a year ago, so this is the second round. And we created these awards to acknowledge that PSU is a leader not only in teaching but in research, and we have some real stellar faculty who we wanted to make sure they got more recognition. We have three categories of these awards. One is for junior faculty, associate and assistant professor. One is for senior faculty at the full professor ranks. And then there's a research faculty category, which this year we did not have any applicants for, candidates for. So today I'm going to talk about two of the recipients of the junior and senior awards, and one of them is here today, and she'll make a few comments as well. So the Junior Faculty Research Excellence Award, you can read right there, was set up to acknowledge junior faculty who are doing great research at PSU. And the recipient this year is Dr. Hamid Mardkhani from the Department of Civil and Environmental Engineering. Hamid was not able to be here today, but he is an expert in water resources and also the effects of climate change on water. And any of you who are skiers who attempted to ski at Mount Hood last year, or if you just look off to the east and look at the lack of snow cover, you can see that this is a very relevant topic for Portland, not just for places like the Desert Southwest, where Dr. Mardkhani was before he came to PSU. Dr. Mardkhani has done a lot of collaborative research internationally. He's out there getting the word about PSU spread to a lot of places, and he's had 50 publications so far as a junior faculty. That's quite good. 30 of them in the last 3 years, so he must have some really good graduate students working with him. let's just acknowledge and give a award for Dr. Mardkhani. So the recipient of the Senior Faculty Excellence Award is Dr. Anna Louise Reisenbach. And Anna Louise is an expert in microbiology and life in extreme environments. And her work and the other faculty that she has gathered at PSU in several departments has really put PSU on the map in terms of where you would go. This is one of the places you would go if you want to learn about life in really weird places. So some of you may have seen the images recently coming back from Pluto, and earlier this year there were some great images of some asteroids. If you were asking yourself, well, is there any kind of weird life that lives there? Anna Louise is one of the people that you would want to ask about that. Her particular research focus has been on hydrothermal vents at the bottom of the ocean, and she's traveled down to see those in little cramped submarines. If she were another foot taller, she probably wouldn't be qualified to do that research. But she has built up a world-recognized research program here, she and her colleagues. She's highly collaborative. She also has included lots of students in this work, and I think she'll talk briefly about that when she comes up here. For all of those things, please join me in congratulating Anna Louise. Yeah, come on up here. We already actually gave out the awards at graduation, so.
So weird life, yeah. I do know about a lot of weird life on PSU. I want to thank PSU and also the Qatar government for giving me this award. This award couldn't have been possible without the support of students, PSU students, high school students from locally, and as well as postdocs and technicians in my lab. None of it would have been possible without them. In addition, from funding from the National Science Foundation. Many of the students and postdocs that have worked in my lab here at PSU have gone on and been highly successful. I have a PhD pharmaceutical student, well, she was an undergrad here, and she is now got a PhD in pharmacy. High school kids, Josh Steinberg is now doing an MD, PhD. I've got postdocs who are graduate students, PhD graduate students, who are faculty members in Florida, in California. So PSU is really moving around through the ability to have been a part of my research program. In addition, a lot of the students, undergrads that joined my research program have really made it very exciting for me to be at PSU. A lot of my teaching is often much more fun to teach when I walk in and say, oh, I found this nice little bug, and the students' eyes get all excited about these weird and wonderful microbes that we're working with in my lab. And so I guess I just want to say thanks again. A lot of this would not have been possible without the support of PSU and the students and everybody else in my department and nationally. And for those of you who want to go on a research cruise sometime, you know, please come talk to me. We can put you to work. And if you want to really see the kind of work we're doing, I am giving a talk at OMSI, I guess this in October, at the Hollywood Theater. So if you want to do the pub lunch or pub dinner or whatever it is, I'll be there and I'll show you all the fun microbes that we work with just across in SRTC. Thank you.
Thank you, Anna Louise. And I should mention that Anna Louise is one of the faculty members from PSU that you're most likely to see in the media. She's gotten a lot of attention nationally and locally, including doing things at OMSI, like she just mentioned. I also wanted to mention that the process for nomination for these awards, the deans nominate the candidates, and we had really strong pools this year, both for the senior and junior awards. So those of you who are deans, make sure that you get us some good nominees next year, and we will continue with this. So now it's my pleasure to introduce Constance French, who is our new interim president of the PSU Foundation. And Constance was the vice president at the OHSU Foundation before coming here. She twice served as the interim president of the OHSU Foundation, and she's going to announce some additional awards.
Thank you, John. Good afternoon. Thank you for including me and the foundation in your convocation. I always love the start of the year on a college campus, so full of hope and energy. We're all still going to get all our grant applications in on time and be ready to mentor our students. It's just like New Year's Eve. All our resolutions are solid and all possible. They're all still possible. Enjoy it. That's the best time of year, in my opinion. It's when reality comes crashing down that we all begin to worry. We've created two awards at the foundation to recognize meritorious service in the area of philanthropy among our faculty. As many of you know, philanthropy is truly something that comes only out of partnerships. And it's partnerships with the institution, partnerships with the foundation, and partnerships with the donors. And the foundation, we have such a tremendously wonderful job in that we get to go out and meet our potential donors, and we get to speak and visit with our alumni. And when we do that, we always ask them, what's important to you? What mattered to you at PSU? And over again, it's you. It's faculty, people who served as advisors and teachers and mentors, and in many cases become lifelong friends. You and your good work make our work a lot easier, so I thank you for that and hope that we can continue to partner with you to advance philanthropy and the vision for PSU and help you achieve all that you're trying to achieve to improve knowledge and education here at the university and well beyond. Our first award, and these are inaugural awards, I'm told, is the, written up here, Faculty Philanthropic Cultivation Award, and this year's recipient is Dr. Robert Gould. Dr. Gould, as you probably know, is co-founder of the Conflict Resolution Program and has been its director for the last 17 years. Additionally, he also established the Friends of Conflict Resolution, an advocacy group that's helped raise funds from individuals and foundations. He also co-founded the Oregon Peace Initiative, and it was then in the 80s when he did that that he came in contact and formed what's been a 30-year relationship with Al Jubitz, a noted philanthropist in the area. And with Al's generous support, Dr. Gould has been able to build a program, the program, into a national leader among peace study programs. And we're so proud to be able to say that and have that affiliated with our university. Over 30 years, Dr. Gould has exemplified partnership needed in cultivation of philanthropic relationships. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Gould to the stage. He's this year's recipient of the PSU Foundation Faculty Cultivation Award.
I thought I'd say a couple of inspiring things about philanthropy development. probably the easiest thing to do is to know somebody who is wealthy. So if you do, you want to talk to the PSU Foundation folks and they'll give you some pointers on the next steps. But the second point is that we don't really know. One of the great American secrets is that we don't really know who are the wealthy people. I lived in Britain for a while, and you could walk around and tell just by looking at people's clothes who the wealthy people were. But in the United States, it's much more informal than that. And so the person sitting next to you, you know, might be coming in some money in the future, so you might want to stay friends with that person. So that's the first pointer. The second thing is that when you don't know, you know, who the wealthy people are, then it's just a good idea to be excited about something at Portland State. It may not be the thing you're doing, because that seems a little self-serving, but for myself, this is an example. I'm a former hippie, and I don't know if you can be a former hippie. Maybe once a hippie, always a hippie. But in any case, I was excited about the research on vaping. You know, you saw that. You know, you get formaldehyde poisoning from high temperature vaping. And that was done by Portland State researchers. You know, we should be proud of that, especially since low temperature vaping seems to be okay. So and you can find some other things, you know, that you're interested in. But if people are excited about Portland State, and our partnerships with community members are always important in a formal sense. But really, you never know when you can bump into somebody who really wants to be generous with us, and we need that. Thanks.
So many key takeaways in those comments. Hard to keep up with the most salient. I think low temperature vaping is high on my list, though. Our second award is recognizing a faculty member for their role as a direct partner in obtaining a significant philanthropic gift. And this year's award goes to Marek Elzanowski. He's a professor in the Faribault Massie Mathematics and Statistics Department. In late 2007, Dr. Massie met with Professor Elzanowski, then the chair of the department, to discuss a big idea. for the department. At the time, Professor Elzanowski had worked closely prior with Dr. Massey to also create two successful lecture series. They worked together on this big idea and ended up funding several faculty positions, a prestigious fellowship, and a lecture series. Faculty members within the department have credited Dr. Elzanowski with creating excitement and coalescing a 25-member plus faculty around a single vision, which is remarkable beyond belief. So that is fantastic, and we credit him with that. They also said that he really brought people together to make this happen, and they recognize his work. They created a framework for an additional gift in which there are three more faculty positions created in computational mathematics and statistics, 5 years of support for five PhD students through the Anna King Fellowship, and continued funding for lectures and colloquium series. For his work with Dr. Massey and other donors, and for his many years of leadership, we are very honored to present Dr. Elzanowski with the inaugural PSU Foundation Philanthropic Leadership Award. Please stand to recognize. Thank you all very much. I'm looking forward to getting to know you better. And next up is Sana Andrews, Provost.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. I think most of you know that I'm your Provost and Vice President for Academic Affairs. And before we get on with some of the more acknowledgments, I want to show you a brief video clip, our fearless video clip, that really sort of embodies our students, our faculty, and our staff here at Portland State, as well as our alumni.
If you want to leave your mark on the world, you can't be afraid to get your hands dirty. You have to grab the moment. Right, because when you are fearless in what you want to accomplish, doors open. At PSU, we believe that knowledge has no limits. That learning doesn't end in the classroom. That students help build cities. That faculty push the boundaries of physics and imagination. And our graduates, let's just say they're not afraid to dream big. Portland State University. Together, we are fearless.
So I'd like to sort of echo Gina's comments and welcome not only our new faculty, but our new faculty and our staff here at Portland State. We actually have 73 new faculty. And I would ask that all of our new employees, staff, and faculty please stand so that we can recognize you. So many of our new faculty are wearing PSU lanyards with name tags. So I want to make sure that when we have the reception after this event that you seek them out, introduce yourselves, get to know them, and they will try to do the same. We also had a number of successful promotions and tenure cycles this year. We had 18 faculty who were promoted to associate professor with indefinite tenure, another two faculty who were awarded tenure only, and then we had 53 faculty who were promoted into other ranks, including emeriti. And those are all listed on our website, but I invite those faculty that were promoted to please stand and be acknowledged. So I am pleased to announce the recipients of the four awards that we have that are named for past leaders in the Division of Academic Affairs. And I'd also like to thank the Qatar government, because these are awards that we've traditionally given. And then, as John mentioned, this is our second year of the research awards. But this year, we were able to actually increase the amount of money of the awards thanks to a very generous gift from the Qatar government. We hope that continues because the recipients this year are great beneficiaries of that, and hopefully next year the recipients will be great beneficiaries of that. So the first Excellence Award that I want to talk about is the Branford Price Millar Award. And this award is given annually to a faculty member in a tenure track or tenured appointment who's demonstrated excellence in all those areas that we look to faculty to excel in: scholarship, instruction, university service, and public service. This year, the committee had two people that they recommended for the award, and so I got the committee recommendation, and they said, there's two people we're recommending, and I said, go back. It was kind of like going, you know, the jury. Go back and just bring me back one name. They went back, they came back, and they said, no, we have two faculty members that are really worthy of this award. So I'm delighted that we actually are able to give the award to two faculty members. So the first one is Talia Bauer, who's the Cameron Professor of Management in the School of Business Administration. And many of you know Talia. She's recognized nationally and internationally and has written seminal and often cited works in her three main research areas of applicant reactions, employee socialization, and onboarding and leadership. Talia is passionate and a caring teacher who consistently delivers well thought out and innovative classes. Her commitment to students carries over to her embrace of online pedagogy, and she's authored highly respected, innovative textbooks. In her mentorship, she's noted for high standards and supporting students through the achievement of their goals while really stretching them. And in addition, she's been editor-in-chief of one of the most prominent management journals in the field. So the Branford Price Millar Award is given in recognition of her outstanding service and achievement. And I'd like to ask Talia to stand because she chose not to come up to the podium, but can you stand? It's okay. And actually be recognized. Our second award for the Branford Price Millar Award goes to Ken Ruoff, who's a professor of history and director of the Center for Japanese Studies. Ken has achieved extraordinary scholarship, teaching, and service accomplishments. He has a national and international reputation on both sides of the Pacific for his path-breaking scholarship. Ken's career as a teacher is remarkable, and he's known and praised for pushing students to excel by compassionate coaching and encouragement while holding them to high standards. His students cite his ability to foster their skill in knowledge acquisition and in critical thinking. Under his stewardship, Portland State University's Center for Japanese Studies has served to strengthen the connections with Japan, and his international work and reputation for excellence has raised the stature of our institution. The Branford Price Millar Award is given in recognition of his outstanding service and achievement. Will you please welcome Ken to come to the podium to make a few remarks?
Thank you. I would also like to thank the government of Qatar, and we'll be talking with Sonia later about tickets for the 2022 World Cup and how we... I am reassured that someone like me, who frankly has at times been openly critical of aspects of the administration, could get an award like this, and I do appreciate that. But in fact, I've had a blast at PSU. I've had a blast with colleagues in history and East Asian studies and a wonderful time teaching PSU students. It is really heartening to take some of these diamonds in the rough, if you will, because we are in many ways a working class institution, and see them go so far. I mean, it's just so meaningful to help students go much farther than they even imagined was possible. But I do want to spend a little bit of my time today touching upon a term that I think has become a little bit muddled at PSU, and I think we should try to work through this muddling, because it is one of the six priorities at PSU, apparently, and that's internationalization. Internationalization is, of course, you know, very, very important, but I think we need to be clear at times what we mean by it, and I look forward to partnering with the administration going forward on this front. For example, it is tremendously meaningful to bring large numbers of Chinese students to PSU during the summer for them to take ESL classes. But in fact, if you step back, that's actually Americanization. That's not really how people like myself would define internationalization, although it's very, very meaningful. For me, and this is why I'm not going to use this term internationalization anymore, what we need to do perhaps even more at PSU, although we do it very well compared to many universities, is to teach our students more about the rest of the world in this day and age. And I hope with the newer environment, the better investment by the state, that we can make more investments in this area of teaching our students more about the rest of the world, because it very much suits the age, it's what the students want, and also, incidentally, it's an area where the social sciences and humanities have so much to offer, as they do in other areas, but they certainly have a lot to offer in this area. So myself, going forward, I'm actually not going to use this term internationalization. I'm going to call upon the administration to invest in areas that help teach our students more about the rest of the world. And thank you.
So our next award is the George C. Hoffman Award, and as you can see, it's given annually to a faculty member in recognition of their distinct contribution to the university in the area of instruction, university service, and scholarship. And this year's recipient of the Hoffman Award is Dilafruz Williams, professor in the Department of Educational Leadership and Policy. Dilafruz is a gifted instructor, imparting life-transforming knowledge through a well-balanced mixture of instruction and hands-on learning. Her accessibility to students is noted as astounding, given her breadth of instruction, scholarly activities, and community service roles. Many former students give her credit for changing the course of their education, their careers, and even their lives. She's been an ambassador for PSU, brilliantly representing our university and the values of sustainability, diversity, service learning, and strong community partnership. In addition to generous public service, Dilafruz is a prolific writer, and like her personal availability to individual students, her scholarship is accessible to a wide array of readers, often transcending academic writing and bordering on musical, as one person noted. The George C. Hoffman Award is in recognition of her dedication, service, and unique achievements. Please join me in welcoming Dilafruz to the podium for brief remarks.
Thank you, Sona. I came to this country from India a few decades ago to study at a university on the East Coast. I did not know a soul in America, nor had I ever flown abroad. It was a terrifying experience, yet exhilarating. Those were the days before cell phones and the internet, and in fact, my parents did not even have a telephone for me to call them to let them know I had reached the dorm safely. Instead, they had to wait 7 days to receive my handwritten airmail letter. Yes, it took 7 days. But for parents who had barely completed eighth grade, and for a father who was himself an immigrant to India, their faith in their daughter was firm as they waited patiently. I distinctly remember the two suitcases that I brought with me as I landed at Logan Airport in Boston. Two suitcases. That's all I had. One had my belongings, and the other suitcase was full of gifts. Gifts from India in anticipation of the new people I would meet. As an immigrant to this country, those gifts were the start of friendships, the likes of which I could never have imagined. Gift giving, sharing a part of me from India, out of love and a warm heart for new friends I was making in the United States. As I now start my 26th year at PSU, I want to share that PSU has given me many a gift. To this day, I still feel excited when I start an academic year. Meeting new students, launching projects, leading them, serving in low-income communities. Every class that I teach, I feel invigorated afresh. Every article that I write, I feel stimulated. Every learning garden that I'm involved with in schools, I feel immense joy and fulfillment. What a privilege it has been to work across disciplines and departments with amazing colleagues. And I see many faces here in the audience today. The precious relationships with students, community members, and my colleagues, these are the gifts that PSU has given me as a faculty member, for which I'm grateful and humbled. I accept the Hoffman Award on behalf of all the nominees this year. Special thanks to Candace Reynolds and Twyla Neske for spearheading the nomination process, and to the other nominators, Jennifer Allen, Amy Spring, Kevin Keskis, and Dean Randy Hitz. Thank you. And of course, to the myriad individuals who wrote letters of support with such care and passion. Many of you are in the audience. Thank you with all my heart. And thanks also to the Hoffman Review Committee and to my son, James, who has been a source of inspiration in every facet of my life. I'd like to close by sharing that in staying true to myself in terms of both how I live and what I profess, it is Gandhi's wisdom that has guided me. My life is my message. Thank you, Provost Andrews and President Vivel, and thank you all. I appreciate deeply.
We okay? All right. Our next award is the Kenneth W. and Elsie W. Butler Award for Library Faculty Service. And this award is given to a faculty member who has excelled in serving our students and serving our faculty and the patrons in the university library. So this year, the recipient of the Butler Award is Jill Emery, Collections Development Librarian and a professor. Jill joined the PSU Library faculty in 2011 with a national reputation in librarianship. Her two ongoing projects, Techniques for Electronic Resource Management, called TERMS, and Open Access Workflows for Academic Librarians, called, looks like AWOL, but I know it's OWOL, have won accolades, including the 2015 Ingram Quartz Award for Innovation in Electronic Resource Management from the American Library Association. At Portland State, Jill is guiding investment in collections that will both serve the demands of the changing higher education landscape and the support of our community in a long-term way. Her colleagues note that she has significantly enhanced collection development within the library, strengthening the library's connection to the Orbitz Cascade Alliance and demonstrating innovation in her field. She has the distinction of having a reputation and really making our library a place of vision and innovation. Please join me in welcoming Jill Emery, recipient of the 2015 Butler Award, to the podium for brief remarks.
I'm extremely humbled to be the 2015 recipient of the Butler Award for Library Service. To say that I follow in the footsteps of Ken and Elise Butler is a tremendous achievement, and I thank both my Portland State colleagues and the Butler family for this honor. We're now well into the age of information, and I'm struck by a thought as I stand before you today. I stand before the wealth of nations. While I'm a dedicated steward to the historic scholarly record, I am most dedicated to collecting the scholarship that is yet to be created by all of us. In this millennium, our scholarship and our knowledge are the prime investments upon which this university and community prospers. We have the possibility to extend our local and global impact outside of expensive and unsustainable paywalls. Continuing our focus only on procuring content from publishers that offer prestige through traditional measures runs counter to the PSU mission of having knowledge serve our city. Together, let's strive to remove the barriers and paywalls instituted by our historic academic norms from a previous era. By utilizing ready dissemination through our institutional repository, adhering to federal public policy, and the expansion of alternative forms of scholarship, our impact can and will be so much greater. Let's work together to develop collections that are widely available both to our local community and the world beyond. Thank you.
Our next award is the Mary H. Compston Award, and this is given to an academic professional or university administrator who's demonstrated excellence in the area of service to students. This year's recipient of the award is Cindy Bakar, our Portland State University Registrar. Cindy has served PSU for 15 years with her commitment to students, her professional dedication, and her technological expertise. With her sane voice of reason, her unwavering integrity, and her student-focused perspective, Cindy is held in high esteem by those who she supervises, as well as by faculty, advisors, and all levels of administrators on campus. She's noted to be one of the best thinkers, analysts, project managers, and department leaders. Her skills have improved our student retention and graduation rates, along with improving the student experience. Some of Cindy's accomplishments include leading the automated degree implementation team, for those of you that are new faculty and staff, that's referred to as DARS, and a successful implementation which revolutionized advising and also improving our classroom scheduling methodology and the management of the PSU pathway system. With compassion and kindness and concern for the success of students, Cindy embodies the spirit behind this award and has been instrumental in moving the campus forward to meet the needs that those who are here. So with that, please join me in welcoming Cindy Bakar to this podium for some brief remarks.
So good afternoon, and thank you for letting me take a few moments of your time this afternoon. And because I don't do this every day, and this is important to me, and I only have 2 minutes, I'm actually going to read my remarks. I am humbled to receive the award, and to my nominators and the committee members, I am deeply touched and appreciative. And thank you for those over-the-top nice letters that were written. I actually took them home this summer to Tennessee, and let my mother read them, and she was truly impressed and overjoyed to read them, and she actually believed every single word. You gave me a very precious moment with her. It was like going back and being a schoolgirl again, bringing home a nice report card for my mom. So oddly, I must say that at least initially, I was uncomfortable in getting this award. Would it surprise you to know that this year's Mary Compston Student Services Award winner doesn't really see students all that often. Is that a puzzle? I felt somewhat inauthentic. My working time is spent mostly in meetings, working on projects, or at my desk, rather removed from students. Of course, many of my colleagues in the registrar's office work with students on a daily basis, but we do not enjoy the more involved and ongoing relationships that faculty and student affairs professionals typically enjoy. In fact, the better we do our jobs, the less we see of students, sometimes. So my discomfort lasted all of 2 seconds when I realized what my winning this award really means. It means that in our community, there is a true appreciation and understanding of the work that is done by people who work behind the scenes to support students and faculty. I hope that my receiving this award showcases and puts attention on all of the amazing work, collaborative, creative, dedicated work that is done by my colleagues in the registrar's office and by our partners across the campus, including IT, student financial services, financial aid, academic affairs, admission, campus planning, graduate studies, and many, many others too numerous to name. I hope that it serves to remind those colleagues how very important their work is to our students. So I cannot receive this award without paying tribute to one of my mentors and champions, my previous boss, Agnes Hoffman, who many of you probably worked with. Agnes, more than almost anyone I know, truly understood and motivated everyone who worked with her to remember why we do this work. It is not about processing the file, or holding to the rule, or managing the data systems. These are means to an end. We do this to help students achieve their educational goals and find their opportunities in life. So thank you all for this, especially to the wonderful colleagues in the registrar's office who make everything possible. I am truly blessed to have found my way to PSU and to this work I enjoy. Thank you.
My congratulations to all the award recipients, and thank you all for being here. Welcome to this convocation and the beginning of the academic year. I want to talk to you just a few minutes about primarily the strategic plan for the university. Let me see whether we can get it up here. Oh, going the wrong way. All right, I'll try that. Okay, very good. Because that is really an effort that's been taking a lot of time last year, and we're now ready to move it into the final stages. But again, first of all, congratulations to all the award winners. Welcome to both all the new faculty and all our faculty and staff. And let's hope that the wonderful weather that we have here this week will stay with us for at least a little while so that all the students will also get to enjoy our campus in this kind of beautiful environment. Before I start talking about the strategic plan, just a few highlights of the past year. This sort of gallery of rogues, these are the seven presidents of the seven former OUS institutions. But what was really amazing that with the demise of OUS, we actually worked together better than ever before. And a big area that we worked on, including all of our boards of trustees, was to jointly lobby the legislature for what we called the $755 million for the biennium for the seven universities together. Well, we didn't quite get to the $755 million, but we got to $700 million, which is pretty good, and which is the reason why I think for the first time since I've been president, we didn't have to go through a cutting exercise. It was kind of a unique experience, but I could get used to it, I tell you. And we're going to come back in the February session to try to get the remaining $55 million. We'll see how far we get on that, but we're pretty optimistic we'll at least get something. We're very proud. As you know, the U.S. News and World Report rankings don't mean a darn thing except for the ones that we're good at. And this one was really good, the most innovative universities, particularly because we have been working at that. If you think about our four-year degree guarantee, our credit for prior learning work, our flexible degrees, our rethink work, so many things that we've been innovating on our new budget model, we are the only university in Oregon that got on this list, and you should give yourself all a round of applause because it's because of our collective work here that we got there. And then I know that nobody comes to Portland State for football, But you know, it's kind of nice when you beat a Pac-12 team. And I think it is, thank you. We are the only undefeated Oregon football team, yeah. But I think more importantly, I have really seen a new spirit in athletics, of a new effort to reach out to the academy. At each of the football games, they will feature a different college. I don't quite know whether that's going to mean, you know, field goal kicking between philosophy and physics or something like that. But I hope that you will respond to that by coming to some of the games, whether it's football or basketball or volleyball, and respond to the work that our athletes, our coaches, and our athletic administrators are doing. Now let me talk about a little bit about our new strategic plan. As you know, last year at this event, the convocation, I told you about the charge that our new Board of Trustees had given us to put together a new strategic plan. We had done one in 2008, which we then updated in 2011, but neither one of those efforts was a very broad-based participatory one. We wanted to now start a campus-wide conversation about the direction that Portland State is going in, how do we balance all the various priorities that we have, and what should we really focus on. And over the past year, we have really had the most extensive discussion about the goals, priorities, and vision of Portland State that probably has ever taken place. Literally thousands of faculty, staff, and students participated. And if that took bribing them with ice cream, so be it. More than 100 people were actively involved on the strategic plan development team and on the topic teams in regular meetings. And then many of you were involved in the ALPS retreat that we had earlier this year in the spring. And I want to show you just a brief video which shows some of the highlights of that ALPS retreat and of the strategic plan.
Scholars and students of color or other diverse groups are attracted to the opportunity to make a difference in their community. So if we sell that opportunity.
I think that the strategic plan is, they're really looking to it to be their North Star.
You know, we spend an awful lot of time getting input and feedback and good ideas and different perspectives from all different kinds of strategies. We had group meetings, individual meetings, meet with different stakeholder groups, web-based feedback. We have thousands and thousands of people giving us ideas. And so to take those thousands of ideas, consider them, put them together in a meaningful package, and so that you can get some really powerful and compelling ideas to lead the strategic plan has been a bit of a challenge, but a lot of fun.
Serving on the strategic plan development team, I've had an opportunity to interface with a really wide cross-section of stakeholders at the campus. We all really want to see the best for Portland State, and we've had some really rich discussions about how to improve our university.
We should read a couple of them to calibrate, yeah. And then we can come back.
The topic teams have been organized around some very major themes. Each of them developed a set of initiatives that they think will move that area forward. But today's the first time we put them up side by side and begin to look at them, and the amount of interconnection and crosswalking between them really suggests to me where there's some really powerful ideas that we can put together when we do the final report, put these together in a very exciting, meaningful way that will show a lot of congruence across all the different people that have been working so hard on this plan.
This is a very important time for Portland State as we move forward. We are an independent institution now and need to make some hard decisions about what we want to be known for, what we want to continue to excel at, and the things that we'll need to drop off.
We're so good in urban everything. That's very interesting to me.
The conditions for higher education are changing in Oregon and elsewhere, and I particularly appreciate the fact that Portland State is taking stock of where we have been and trying to leverage what we currently do as we anticipate the future.
I've been really, really pleased with the level of student engagement with the strategic plan development so far. We've really had some students come out of the woodwork to give their two cents and offer their input into the strategic plan, and it's just been a really heartwarming experience.
It's inspiring to be a representative for grad students, you know, like it's a heavy responsibility, but it is also exhausting in its way. And I am only but one voice that, you know, that represents, you know, a couple thousand students that really don't have any kind of meaningful representation within the greater university.
Putting students first is really going to be critical to our success as a university. Faculty are clearly important. Finances are important. Affordability is important. But student success is really what we as an institution have to be focused on.
We need to find out exactly now, before students become alumni, what are their needs and how can we address it? How do we support them? And a lot of it, for at least the Alumni Association, is about connections.
Plan writing is always a complicated affair, but you know, plans get written all the time. The trick is an implementation.
I think my big hope is that the strategic plan doesn't become a laundry list, but actually becomes a set of guiding strategic themes for the university that help us decide what not to do, as well as where to really put our energy and resources. We need to have a document that gets us all on the same page, where we're accountable and say, hey, we went through a really rigorous process to prioritize these sets of issues, and we're going to stick by them, and we're going to see them through.
Over the summer, a small writing team took all that material and put together a draft of what had been discussed that is now being sort of whipped into final shape by the strategic plan development team again. And early next month, they will be releasing that as the draft strategic plan that will be brought to the broader community. And both the Student Senate and the Faculty Senate will be asked to comment on it directly, but many others will have opportunities as well, and I'll come back to that in a minute. What you see here, I'm not going to go through the whole strategic plan, but it has a couple of key components. One of them is what we call the strategic clarity piece, which talks about the vision, the mission, values, and so on. And then the second main part talks about the substance, the five main themes. So this is the current version. Now, by the way, there's still a draft. Everything could still change, although this one won't change very much because it's been kicking around for a while now. And as you will see, both in the vision and then in the mission statement that'll be on the next slide, we try to balance the talk about opportunity and excellence, the focus on the local and the global, the teaching, the research and the engagement, the liberal arts, and applied work. You see that in this vision, and you see it also in the mission, which fortunately has a few more words, so we can balance all of that. You see again the notion of focusing on the region as well as the world, on issues of sustainability and engagement as sort of our key identifiers and how we differ from other universities, and of course the mentioning of the research and the teaching. We spend a lot of time on values. What is our unique position? What do we want to be known for? Again, very important here, I like this first one particularly, that access, inclusion, and equity are not sort of balanced with excellence. No, they're pillars of excellence. You can't have excellence as we define it without access, inclusion, and equity. Our excellence is not built on exclusion as it is in so many institutions. The plan then goes on to talk about five themes listed here. Those of you who knew how to recite the five previous themes by heart, as I'm sure you all did, we'll recognize much of it. Obviously, a focus on student success. Obviously, a focus on excellence in teaching and research. What we called previously provide civic leadership through partnership comes back here as strengthening leadership in engagement, building on a history that we've had as an institution for a long time. A commitment to equity is called out much more explicitly than it was in the previous plan. And then finally, innovating for long-term sustainability, which talks about the wide variety of challenges of both organizational innovation and strength and financial stability. This slide provides just a few examples. Under each of those five themes, there are about 4 to 5 specific initiatives, sometimes as many as 6. So this is just exemplary of some of those kinds of initiatives that we will have. The plan will not go into total detail about the precise implementation. We'd wind up with a 100-page working document. That will come both in the course of the year, and frankly, it's already being done by a lot of committees and task forces and organizational units in the university. You know, a strategic plan at its best should actually have no surprises. It should not be about going in a totally different way. It should find a way to capsulize and verbalize what we already know we are and where we want to head, but then also give us a framework and an agreed upon set of words and concepts that we can use to make decisions about the future. And that's, I think, what this working draft is currently doing. And as I said, it will still undergo some more work. This is one of those word clouds of just running all the words in the plan through the counter. And as you would expect, and as is right, the word students comes up most often. I was pleasantly surprised about community coming in so often. Faculty, research, teaching and learning, if you put those together, of course, they're also very big. They're pretty much the same, you know, two sides of the same coin. Words like equity and engagement. I think they just give you a very quick synopsis of what this plan is about. Now, we hope that the discussion we've had will make clear that we continue to be jointly dedicated to this concept of let knowledge serve the city, but there will still be different opinions on the relative importance and emphasis on any one theme or particular initiative. But I hope it helps clarify that if at a certain point one thing gets done, one thing gets talked about or invested in, it doesn't mean that other things are not important. For instance, by clearly acknowledging both research and high-quality teaching, we don't mean that when we provide money for research that the teaching is not important. Or when we invest in advisors, it doesn't mean we don't care about faculty. It talks about engagement with Portland, but it's always presented as ultimately serving the whole nation and the world. You know, we all know that we're not going to get many national rankings for all of our programs, whether it's in the humanities or hard sciences. But it doesn't mean that a class like Anne McLennan's, which used the illuminated manuscripts, is not absolutely an amazing, wonderful opportunity for our students to delve into something that just taught them everything about how important the combination of history and economics and warfare and art and availability of materials and how things are preserved over time, how that all comes together to deepen one's understanding of both another culture and one's own. You know, applied fluid dynamics, for which we got a lot of international attention because of our espresso cup that was used in the space station, you know, that is great stuff. And we should continue to do that work, even though we will never be the world leader in space research. But we have specific people who just do amazing and stunning work that rightly brings attention to the institution. We are, though, a world leader in how you connect university knowledge and learning to dealing with local challenges and opportunity. And that's where our emphasis on equity, I think, really comes in. As we all know, the growing inequality in this country is a critical issue that must be dealt with. And as a university, we're dealing with it through the very things we do, the teaching and providing opportunities. But also many of us are explicitly dealing with it through the research that we do, the way that we help students succeed, the financial aid that we provide, and so on. And the plan now has a much greater level of detail on how we focus on issues of equity and diversity. During the next 2 months, we will have a final round of discussions. This plan will be our North Star, as Raylene McMillan said, but it does not take the place of all the millions of more routine things that we also all will continue to do. We will again, as a way of getting broader input, have another strategic ice cream. This one is mostly aimed at students. But then for the grown-ups, we will also have a sliders and suds on November 5th for faculty and staff. So I hope to see many of you there. And our plan to end with another, not gallery of rogues, but the gallery of our wonderful new Board of Trustees, our plan is to deliver this strategic plan to the Board of Trustees for their approval in December. As you can see, we still have a lot of work to do, but a lot has been done already, and I look forward to working with many of you as we finalize this plan, as well as work on the many, many other things that we will do together. I want to thank everyone for coming here together, and it's now my pleasure to invite you all to join us for some food and some drinks. Thank you very much, and go Vikes!